episode number 23 with Steve Tepper. Welcome to In It to Win It. This is Stevie B.
And Dan G.
Dan G. You you just came in drenched on a motorbike, huh?
Oh, yeah. I'm completely drenched. No joke. It's just didn't check the weather report, obviously, today.
So you're out there playing Frogger when it's raining?
Pretty much. Kind of like Mad Max, just with better weather. No joke. It's no joke.
Nice. So this week we have Steve Tepper. He's a kind of a consultant for building accessory dwelling units, basically like a second home in your backyard.
Granny flat.
Granny flat, yes. So you're going to hear ADU about 900 times when we start the interview. And that's what we're talking about, accessory dwelling unit.
Accessory dwelling.
We actually already recorded this, and you've been sitting here dripping wet like a wet dog.
No, I'm dry.
You're dry now.
Okay. Yeah. Luckily, I was gonna go to the gym earlier, but I realized I didn't have enough time, so I got kind of that quick dry gear on a little.
Yeah. Nice.
Hell, it's helping. It's paying dividends right now.
Right. Pro tip.
Yeah, pro tip.
But it was a good interview, man. I learned a lot.
Yeah. Yeah. He's a very informative, guy, has a lot of experience and, save you a lot of money.
Yeah. I'm going to hire him before I purchase the property to just have him look over it and go like, yes or no.
Yeah, seriously. Like, hey, does it have good bones? You know?
Yeah. Yeah. Are we good to go here? Do you see anything blatantly obvious?
Yeah, is it going to give you the lick the finger in the wind tip?
Yeah.
Yep, it's good. Bone that way. We're good.
Yes.
He's a wealth of him. He's definitely a pretty wealth of information. Has a lot of been building a while and has a lot of a lot of recommendations on things. A lot of things I asked him and I thought I knew, and I realized that was stupid.
Yeah, I found the same thing when, you guys were here in the interview, but it's a good one. I didn't get a chance to read that story you sent me about the something about Japanese panty thief or something.
Oh yeah, they finally caught him.
This guy's been at large for a long time.
He's been at large for quite some time now. The name obviously is Japanese. I just can't remember the exact name, but yeah, they caught him. 791 pairs of panties they caught him with.
Wow, he almost got to 800.
Yes. Well, almost. You know, the funny thing is they have, and I don't know this because I haven't been, but I know that this is for a fact that they have actual vending machines that, with, I know that sounds disgusting, but it's just the truth with like soiled panties. I'm like,
oh God.
Obviously, it was just too cheap to go to the vending machines they have in Japan. So he just, figured he just steal a whole bunch.
He's just been breaking into people's homes and taking their panties.
Well, most of it's been at laundromats.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
That's a professional right there.
Yeah, he's a professional panty thief. And the funny thing is that he's not the only one. And the article is funny because I've heard about this before, and it's almost like Japanese folklore or something, but but it's like it's a thing over there. It's very strange and odd, but Japanese men seem to really like stealing women's underwear.
Interesting. All right. Sounds like a lot of guys got to get better to talking at women is what I hear.
you could
if you talk to them nice enough, they'll give them to you. You don't have to
maybe
steal them.
Maybe you can work something out, like, one a week.
Yeah. Work out some kind of deal.
Yeah. Be like, hey, I got some oranges on the tree. Maybe we can trade.
Promise not to tell anyone.
Yeah. Full disclosure.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's awesome.
So you were Steve, you just came back. Are you red or are you like, what color are you right now?
Oh, I'm quite attractive right now. I've got a nice sun-kissed bronze look. It nice. You wouldn't even recognize me, I swear.
No peeling.
No peeling. And I will say that tan fat looks far better than white fat.
You know, I've always thought that myself.
Yeah, it's true. It's true.
Yeah.
I'm living proof. I have before and after pictures. It's quite stunning.
Oh, you were talking about yourself. I thought you were talking about like just other people in general.
Yeah, he's still fat, but he's tan.
Yeah. You know, that is a thing, right? But he has a tan.
Yeah, he's got a nice tan. Yeah,
I just it's kind of like a photo. It's like a filter.
Yeah, it's a filter. You don't need to press the filter on me anymore.
Yeah.
I'm good to go.
So did you use any like SPF or just a Crisco, or what'd you do to yourself?
Honestly, I did not put sunscreen on except for my face, but I was in the shade like all the time.
Okay.
And when I went out into the water, I didn't put on sunscreen. I just swim. And so I never got burned. It was just like this little bit every day in kind of micro doses, and never peeled, gotcha. Never burned.
So you were conscious of, the sun, right?
Yeah, I was.
Yeah.
As a blanquito gringo.
Yeah,
definitely.
You're a blonde haired, blue eyed, white skinned man.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Oh, I did have an interesting experience at the bar.
Is this the bar at the, there's a bar down in the river? Or
So we got a buddy with a little camper trailer that we'll stay in right on the river. And then we can walk down maybe a football field and a half. And there's a little floating bar on the side of the river. So it's a fun place to go get lunch or something.
Yeah.
Anyways, we were over there the night before we left. And three guys came in. And one of them, I said, hey, what's up to? And then he started showing me pictures on his phone of a bunch of agave plants. And I'm like, oh, okay, this is weird. And then he said his dad owned all the agave fields in somewhere in Mexico. And
why did he just, he led with that now?
He kind of, yeah, that's what I thought was a little odd, was he led with it. And
he said, hey, I'm Steve. And he's like, I'm Juan, or like, and here's my pictures.
I don't remember his name, but yeah. And he just starts showing me pictures on his phone. And I'm like, okay, he's obviously got a bit of an ego here. Maybe I'll learn something about tequila production. What I mean?
Maybe I'll get a discount on my next bottle.
Yeah. And I'm like, well, his dad owns all these things in Mexico. And he said, so I own them all in Mexico. And I'm
did
like,
he say that proudly? Like,
he
so
did,
I
yeah.
owned them all.
Yeah, exactly. And I was like, okay.
Whatever.
And so, but his accent was real heavy. And I was like, I think he would be more comfortable talking in Spanish.
Wait, let's get this straight. Did he talk in a
Mexican accent speaking English?
Okay, but not right. Like, hey, Holmes.
No, not thuggish at all.
Not thug gangster Spanish.
No.
Oh, okay, I just want to make sure let everybody know.
Okay, I guess I got to specify.
Yes.
And so I start talking in Spanish, and I was like, tell me about the process.
He was blown away.
That's when he was, there was like a total mind fuck that just went across his face, and he was like, wait, the whitest guy in the whole bar is just rapping in Spanish right now. And he's all, I don't speak Spanish. I didn't even skip a beat. I was like, eres el dueño de todo en México y no hablas español? And I said, you're the owner of all of Mexico and you don't speak Spanish? And he's like,
huh?
I just got a lot of agave plants out there. And I'm like, all right, I think I totally insulted him, but I just couldn't help it. I was so shocked. I was like, dude, you led with this conversation.
And I'm trying to go with it. And you're like, you're pissing on the Cheerios here. Yeah.
Then the guy went over. This is when I knew he was a real winner. The cops show up about 20 minutes later, and I come to find out that he threatened the DJ. I don't know what he said to him, but it was enough for the DJ to call the cops.
Why did he threaten
and
the DJ?
Now the DJ, this is I know him because I go out there enough. DJ Timmy, right?
DJ Timmy,
yes. And really, really good DJ, very handicapped. I mean, it took him 5 minutes to walk about 30 yards to his spot on the DJ booth. So my point is, this guy was about 6'5" and probably 250 pounds. And he went up and threatened that guy out of everyone in the bar. Like, what a winner, you know?
Wow.
And he gets kicked out by the cops. I couldn't believe
wow.
it.
Yeah, that's I don't even know what to say. Well, I think it's pretty glorious that you rapped him in Spanish.
At first, I felt a little bad about it, but then after I saw that, I'm like, oh, screw
then me. You only talk to him in Spanish after
yeah,
that.
Exactly.
Tú no sabes nada. Pendejo. that's glorious. That's awesome, man. Well, I'm waiting for that to happen to me since I'm newly found in my Spanish, Steve.
Yeah. How's your Spanish coming?
Well, ever since I thought I had the key to learning Spanish, but now I really have the key to learning Spanish.
What is that?
It's called buy a scooter or a motorcycle and drive it in a Spanish country for at least a month.
You'll learn real quick.
Because you got to do all this shit all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm completely forced. Like, matter of fact, my Spanish, the guy who is actually lives in the city that I'm in Bucaramanga, or actually a little, he actually lives a couple hours out of town. He happened to be in town. So he's like, hey, let's meet up, amigo, da da da. And so we met up and we spoke entirely in Spanish the whole time. He's like, well, you don't really, are we doing a lesson right now or are we just meeting up?
Oh, that was your Spanish. Like, you don't need.
Yeah, that was my Spanish too, but he's like, you don't really need me. I'm like,
you've outgrown him. Fantastic. Good for you, man.
Yeah, kind of outgrew him. Well, not completely, but you know, it's he was very impressed that because I knew a lot of words that are kind of inherent to Colombia. They have a lot of words for like cool. You know, they say chévere or chimba or they. Or they say this in the streets, it's like, well, it's kind of slang gangster, but they say chimba. They say he's like, oh,
chimba. Yeah.
And just all these little, like, if you want to have some beers, it's like echelas frios, or like, it's just all these little slang terms that are thrown out. And he's like, what the hell?
Yeah, that are very specific to that area. Yeah,
exactly. So, it was cool. It was like a good vote of confidence there, you know?
Good. Yeah, you were doing Skype lessons with him while you were here in America, correct?
Yeah, I was, and I was struggling.
Okay. And what was he, like $8 an hour or something? Or
Yeah, he's a, $8 an hour. I mean, God, can you go wrong? Okay. Yeah, $8 an hour Skype, great guy. Real easy, just going over, everything and just, we've talked about this before, but just learning the language is just, it's not easy,
Yeah.
Unless you're like 10, and you're a sponge, but. Yeah, it's been a journey, and it's cool to actually finally be able to kind of converse and know what the people on the next dinner table are saying about you.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool. Right on. Well, should we bring in Steve?
Yeah, let's bring on Mr. Tepper.
All right, Steve Tepper. Steve Tepper, thank you for coming on the show.
Well, thank you for having me.
Yes. Now, how did you and Daniel meet? Because it looks like you're going to be helping Daniel with his ADU.
Well, through another mutual friend who's actually our car mechanic. I'm doing an ADU for him. So Daniel was talking to the mechanic, and one thing led to another. Daniel gave me a call, and the rest is history. I'm working on his plans right now, in fact.
Yeah, I'm excited.
Nice. So you, maybe you could just go 2 minutes into your story, how you got started with, construction and I guess, to now where you are with ADUs.
Yeah, well, basically, I started in construction at a pretty young age. I think I was about 12 or 13. I worked in my dad's precision specialty wood shop, making a variety of wood products and finishing and whatnot. And I worked for him for quite a few years. And then through college, found myself still working in construction to make ends meet and everything. I became a general contractor in 1990. That was a Class B license with a home improvement certificate as well, which allows you to do home improvements, additions, and things like that. So I was a hands-on contractor. I like to do everything, kind of, or be involved in the whole thing, from ground preparation, foundation,
framing, drywall,
everything. Yeah, the whole enchilada.
Whole enchilada. So then a few years ago, I kind of got older and retired, semi-retired. And so that's where I'm at now, just kind of helping people with the ADU stuff, which judging from a lot of people I've talked to, the experience dealing with some of the municipalities and building departments is a little bit tough. And having a little bit of experience, or actually a lot of experience doing that, I can kind of smooth the road forward for those people. So that's how I got into the ADUs.
Yeah. Okay.
That's why I wanted to start working with Steve, so he can smooth that whole smoothing thing.
Yeah,
it's kind of interesting, you know, and it needs a lot of smoothing, and yeah, you know, and some municipalities are easier than others. We just happen to live in one that's one of the tougher ones.
Okay. You know, now, do you specifically do Santa Barbara County, or do you do Ventura County or other counties as well? Or do you specialize in Santa Barbara?
Everywhere.
Okay.
You know, within reason. Yeah. Don't know if I'm going to fly up to Tahoe or something, but.
Okay. Southern California.
Mainly Southern California. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. What's, I've been interested in this personally, and Daniel is specifically because he's doing it now, but I would like to get a place in Ventura, something like what Daniel has, although probably a smaller lot size. And so basically I'm looking for a house in the front and an open lot in the back, or I guess I'd be okay with the opposite as well, the main house in the back with a big front yard, and I think you could do the same thing. Is one better than the other, or are they both just... what you want?
You know, I think that for aesthetic wise and future resale, I think having the ADU in the back is probably a better way to go. You know, there's the other option of converting a garage or part of a house you can convert into an ADU as well. It's I think that the separate building is a kind of a nice way to go, in that it keeps everybody separate, and you have your own kind of lifestyle that you can live. But since they passed a law in California, they've allowed a little more leeway in the setbacks and things like that, so you don't have to have the rigorous approval of different municipalities. Yeah. So like for instance, here in Santa Barbara, the setbacks are at a minimum of 4 feet instead of like 10 or 20 feet sometimes. So really makes it a lot more appealing. You can put them in a fairly small backyard. You know, there are size limitations on the ADUs too, depending on the configurations and whatnot.
Hey, Steve, was the setbacks, were they, since you said, is that more of a recent thing, that kind of, you know, four foot setbacks? Before they were like a lot, they wouldn't allow it before at such a small space?
Exactly.
Okay. I didn't realize that they were so large, like, you know, 10, 15 feet. Well, you know,
and it also depended on open area. There's, you know, used to be requirements in most cities to where you'd have to have so much open area per bedroom and per size of the house. So
now
that's gone away, and, you know, you can get within 4 feet of your sides and backs. Some of the front setbacks, if you do put an ADU in the front yard, they can be like up to like 10 feet. So some of those are a little bit different. Just depends on what building department you're dealing with.
What, you know, you kind of made me think of something. When I was picturing getting the lot with the house in the back and an empty front yard, I was imagining building a bigger house in front and kind of making the second one the ADU. But that would be completely different in construction, right? And kind of go against, that wouldn't even be an ADU then, would it?
That wouldn't be an ADU.
That would be a whole nother ball game and a lot more expensive than getting the bigger house already in the front and then putting a smaller one behind. Is that correct, Steve?
Correct. Yes, definitely.
Wow. Okay. You just saved me a huge mistake. Thank you.
Just think of it like this, Steve. It's like a mullet. Business in the front, party in the back.
Oh, God.
Wow, that would have been an atrocious error.
Yeah, I heard mullets are coming back.
This is why we do this, Daniel.
Steve, just think of Steve and I as just, you know, kids in the backseat of the bus with like helmets and stickers on our head.
Okay? Yeah, we're licking the windows on the bus. Yeah.
We're blowing like hot breath on the window, writing our names out. Gosh.
Wow, I gotta redo my vision board. That would have been an awful mistake. Okay. Well, moving on. Okay, well, that right there kind of leads me into my first question. What are some common mistakes for first-timers, Steve?
trying to do it themselves and walking blindly into a building department.
Okay.
Without getting a little bit of knowledge up front of what you want to do. Yeah.
I did that.
experience talks. So if you do a little bit of homework, you can, you know, kind of start picking out styles of ADUs. There's tons of them online that you can look at. And if you want to, you know, go the route of maybe doing it yourself, there's a lot of drafting people out there that can just draw your plans for you at a reduced rate. Some of the places that are selling the ADUs, they're selling plans, you know, that they want a nice amount of money for it. Not that that's bad. If you've got the money to spend on it, then that
if you don't care.
But yeah, if you do a little bit of homework, you can get, you know, because you're gonna have structural engineering, Title 24, which is your, you know, energy calculations and all these things. And you know, if you go to like some companies, they can charge you an arm and a leg. And if you just do a little bit of research, you can save a ton of money.
So, okay.
Yeah. As opposed to, you know, getting an architect involved. So basically, Steve, what you're saying is we don't really need to have an architect involved. You can actually kind of bypass all that and get a draft, you know, get somebody to draft you some plans.
Exactly. Not to badmouth
architects. No, absolutely.
You know, they have their place. I think that ADUs, you know, are just, I don't know, in my experience, it'd be more of a hassle for an architect than what it's really worth, you know. And you're paying a lot of money just for something that you can get online and pretty much design your own. And you know, it's not a hard process to, you know, do up some drawings and stuff. So okay. And it's fun too.
Okay. Yeah. I watched a YouTube video on a guy who does what you do up in the Bay Area. And he was saying that a lot of people, they get this idea of an ADU and they go to an architect and tell them what they want. And they come up with these elaborate drawings and everything. And the first thing they do when they hand it to a guy like you is you go, oh, well, the setbacks are actually 10 feet and they drew it for 6. And so none of this will work.
But it's a really pretty picture.
Yeah, I'm glad you paid 10 grand for these, but they're essentially useless.
I just read where the cost of ADUs in the Bay Area can get up to like $390 a square foot.
Yeah.
You know, well, and that's for, yeah. You know,
yeah, that's comparable.
Square foot building. That's ridiculous.
Yeah. What kind of cost do you have here?
Well, it depends on your finishes and things like that, but it's very easy to build for $100 a square foot.
$100 a square foot.
You can do it, and even less if you really are diligent at you know, purchasing the right things. And you know,
what kind of countertops and flooring do we got for $100 a foot?
You can get you know, a lower grade granite countertops. Flooring, you know, there's such a variety of flooring these days. There's some pretty nice laminate vinyl flooring that looks exactly like wood.
Yeah.
Installs very simple.
Yeah. I have that. Yeah, I have that. And
oh, yeah. That's what nobody, you got in your place.
Nobody knows. Well, now they do, but. Gotcha.
That's out of the bag.
Imported from Cyprus.
I know.
On like, the backs of donkeys for weeks. Yeah.
There goes my import story.
No, actually, it was Home Depot.
Got it at El Home Cheapo.
Yeah. But it looks great. I've seen it.
No. I got it at like a flooring warehouse store. Okay.
Yeah. Well, that's the way you can save money for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, no, yeah. Absolutely. They got a great, there's so much variety. It's almost hard to choose what to get because there's so much variety now. It's just crazy. So I'm really happy.
And then, you know, another thing is if you're willing to, you know, buy some of your materials out of like an expensive area like Santa Barbara or San Francisco, you can save thousands of dollars, you know, like on, yep, on trim, things like that. It's just amazing.
Yeah. You bought a lot of stuff. Get it in bulk. I did that. Go to the neighboring city that is.
That's what I did. I bought all my roofing. I bought, and actually in your city, Steve, well, I bought it in the city of like Oxnard and more, a little bit towards LA.
Yeah.
And I got, you know, I immediately got at least 20%, about 20% easy, you know, 15 to 25% off.
And they deliver for free.
Yes. Yeah. So that's actually, if you live in an expensive area, just go outside of the city and buy your materials. You will save a ton of money.
That's the truth. It is the truth. That's, I mean, I did it on my house as well. My roofing came from Ventura.
So. Yeah, yeah, same here. So there you go, Steve. You don't even need to go anywhere.
Oh, that's nice. That's nice. What, so like, what's the process from start to finish? Like something what Daniel's going to do. What are you doing? 1,000 square feet, Daniel?
I think I can go up to, Steve, correct me if I'm wrong, because you know more than me. I'm the sticker licker. So, but I believe I can do like 1,250. I think that's my max. Like it's 625 or.
It's kind of a gray area. Combining what you're going to do with the garage down below. Yeah, you can do 1,250.
Got it. Yep. Okay.
So, and with your lot size and everything, I think I've got your upstairs area at somewhere around 700.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's,
cool.
It's, that's we'll go over that later.
Yep. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nice. I'm not complaining. So.
Yeah. So what's the process from start to finish? Maybe we can just use Daniel's place as an example. Well, like, is it a 12-month timeline, 18, 24? Like what, you know, from start to finish, if it's 10 steps or something, you know?
Yeah. The initial startup is to, you know, pick out a design, get somebody to draw some plans, some elevations, and just, you know, some basic sketches or whatever to get started as to what you want. Then the next would be to, you know, check with your particular city to make sure they're not throwing any little fun things out. Santa Barbara tried to tell people that if they were in the coastal zone, they couldn't have an ADU. So they, California said, no, you're wrong. City of Santa Barbara sued the state and lost. So, live in the coastal zone and have an ADU, no matter where you live in Santa Barbara. Yeah. And that's the whole idea behind an ADU. It's to make affordable housing, which we're so short on housing and areas to build housing anymore. So anyway, the next step then would be to, you know, check with the municipalities as to what the requirements are. You want to then probably have a soils test done, which is getting a soils engineer to go out to the property. They test the compaction of the soil and make sure that it's safe to build something wherever you want to build it. And then next, get your plans drawn up, basic framing done, drawn, and get it to a structural engineer. And they will figure out all the structural details, which every building department's going to want to see that. So these are, you know, some of the initial costs that you'll run into. And if you, again, do your due diligence in shopping, you can find people that do it really reasonably. Especially be careful for in your area, Steve, be careful of soils engineers. For some reason, down in Ventura, there's a couple really expensive ones.
I thought you meant that they're, you know, they're standing in quicksand and they're like, no, it's good.
No.
Check. Thumbs up.
It'll be fine. Bedrock, bedrock.
So, and then you get all your things together. You can start figuring out your costs of what your finishes are going to be. You want to have that ahead of time so you don't have surprises going down the road. You know, and I think that a lot of people, they tend to want to make the ADUs really nice, which in some cases for, you know, if you're going to have a relative live in it, that's great. And you want to do that. If you're just going to use it for a rental purposes to offset your mortgage payments or whatever, you know, you can go with a lot lesser brands and quality, basically. You know, you can go with nice laminate countertops. You can go with
that's what mid-range, I've done in all my rentals, laminate
things like that. Yeah. Mid-range appliances and stuff. You don't need to have sub-zero refrigerators and stuff like that.
No, so. Vikings.
Yeah. They're nice, but
yeah, yeah.
You pay for it. So, you know, I tend to have people write down what they want initially as far as their finishes go. And then if they want me to, I can give them, you know, three ranges, you know, a low, medium, and high range of what they're looking at. Yeah. So, yeah, I've been doing that for customers for quite a while, and it seems to give them a good idea as to what they're coming into as far as what their expenses are going to be at the end stage when they're finishing things. Okay. So,
alleviating the sticker shock.
exactly.
Yeah, because changes can be costly too, as well, Steve. God. Isn't that right? I mean, if they want to change something on the fly, I mean, that's why it's better stick with the plan, right?
It's definitely stick with the plan. If you're a married couple, let the wife pick out all the colors. I actually had a couple I built a house for, and by the time the house was done, they got divorced.
Yeah.
Wow. They could not agree on anything.
I totally believe it.
Oh God, it was terrible. So
if your marriage survives a remodel, she's a keeper.
Those are a few little tips.
Yeah. I want to know what the worst story you ever had with the couple was.
Well, you don't want to know.
You're just standing there like the awkward third guy in the room as they're screaming at each other. I'll come back tomorrow.
Yeah. It was exactly like that.
Wow.
With that same couple. And, you know, the one's on one side of the room and I'm in the middle. The other's on the other side and they're yelling at each other and they're going, isn't that right, Steve? And
I don't know.
Oh, man. It's not my house.
Oh, God. You're all what color? I don't care. Just tell me. That's funny. Okay. So you get the soils tech out there. You get the basic plans, what kind of finishes they want. Then you start bringing in concrete and foundation or septic.
You're going to initially start with your grading. Mm-hmm. Most soils places engineers are going to recommend a recompaction of, digging up the dirt, compacting it down to, 90% or better. Mm-hmm. And that's not usually a too big of a thing. You need to decide if you want it on a raised foundation or a slab. And then at that point, then once you decide, then you have your concrete people come in and do it. However, and then after you have your forms all set, you have your rough in plumbing and electrical done, anything that's going to be in the ground, you want that done ahead of time. And then pour the slabs or whatever, and you start putting framing up after that.
Okay. What do you recommend, the raised foundation or the slab?
You know, right now I recommend a slab, mainly because the cost of lumber has gone up. It's coming back down a little bit, but if you... There's a lot more lumber involved in a raised foundation. A little less concrete, but concrete's not that expensive. When you're doing something that has a small footprint, it's really insignificant. But so I'm recommending slab foundations right now.
Okay. And on a two-story, Steve, that's kind of almost kind of goes without saying.
It's easier to supply all the structural integrity by doing it on a slab. If you do it on a raise, you've got what's called grade beams, certain wide concrete poured in the ground beams that go across and stuff to support.
I helped my dad construct his house and he just did it on a slab and no raised foundation, so that's all I was familiar with. Okay, cool. Then it goes up in sticks and throw the roof on and drywall.
Now there's ways you can, there's companies that do prefab or kit homes or pre-framed. And I used to do quite a few of those, and it was kind of a nice thing where there's companies around that they frame your project in a factory. So everything's nice and square and plumb. Mm. And some places even put the windows in.
Wow.
Deliver it to your site. And, you know, in a day you have walls.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's it can go up very, very fast if you're, you know, interested in something like that. You pay a little bit more, but you're actually saving money on framing time. So it's kind of a wash.
Huh. Do you still do that, Steve, with companies or?
Yeah, I still have connections with a couple companies. That are, you know, they've been around for a long time, so
yeah,
they're good. But there's more of those companies out there now, so it's more of a choice. And it's not exactly rocket science, but the nice thing is that, you know, they put the walls together on jigs, so everything is just, you know, square, it's right on.
It's perfectly square.
It's perfect, so there's no questions when you're standing up your walls. Yeah, we did a large house with double walls in Somas down in your part of the woods. Neck of the woods. In fact, you can see it from the freeway. I'm not going to say the guy's name. He's not my favorite person.
But if you're listening.
He's not. Anyway, it was about a 10,000 square foot house. And,
that's a huge house.
We double walls, we had it all framed in a week.
Wow.
And that's about seven man crew.
A modular.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pre-framed. Okay. Walls came on trucks, several trucks. And we just unloaded them with a forklift, started standing them up. And so the framing was pretty much done as far as the walls are concerned within a week. So you can really save some time
on 10,000 square feet. That's a lot.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. But what you're doing, Daniel, is stick.
Yeah. I just figured, you know, I control it a little bit better, but yeah, that's just me. You know, I mean, I looked into the modular, you know, so I guess maybe I didn't look into it enough. I don't know, but I just didn't want to, like, a crane or something going over the house. All like, you know, I'm like, I just remodeled.
Yeah, that
this
would
thing.
Suck if they just dropped it on the one part that's all nice and perfect. You know?
It can be a little scary.
Yes, I know. I'm like,
have you ever seen any accidents like that?
I did some work with a crane company a while back. When construction got slow, I went to work for a crane company and, I saw a couple of things. A little scary. Yeah,
see, he's confirming it, Steve. I told you they want the crane over the house.
You're going to do what?
Not often, but they can happen. Yeah,
but it does happen. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, most crane operators, they're a different breed. They really are.
They're overnight truck drivers.
No, they're worse.
Oh, wow.
Oh, I kind of picture them as semi-doctors or like, a helicopter pilot just with the finest minutiae, but you're blowing that paradigm out of the water.
They are to that, but they'll push the limit. Like, if they'll have their outriggers on the high side 3 feet off the ground, and it's like,
oh, wow.
It looks like it's going to tip over, and they're going, nah. Until it does. Wow. But it doesn't happen often.
Okay.
But no. There's good crane operators. They have to be good to get paid enough.
I remember we were talking, I think it was last week, and you mentioned a drywall tip that you had. Could you go over that?
Oh, sure. Yeah, if you got a small, it works really good. Small holes that are in between studs.
Okay.
If you're, you know, if it's a large one, it's easier just to go from stud to stud and cut it out and put a big square piece in. But if you're just doing a small one, like somebody punches a hole in a wall or something, which does happen with renters and things, it's easy to, you cut a kind of, you know, if you can square off the hole a little bit, it's easier. And then cut a piece of drywall that will go inside the hole, but a little bit longer. Wider or taller, top to bottom or side to side. You hold that piece with a drywall screw in the middle. So you hold that, you put it in the hole, you hold it tight up against the wall from the inside. That's why you have the drywall screw in the middle of your piece. And then you put two drywall screws in either side next to the hole, or on top of bottom next to the hole. Then once you have those in, you can take that center drywall screw out and you cut a piece to fit inside your hole. I like to use some caulking, like some Alex Plus caulking, painter's caulk, to hold it in place. Then that way you don't need to have a lot of drywall mud and a lot of sanding and stuff like that. So it works out, pretty nice. And then you can put your little mud on the cracks. And then there's ways to fake in texture. Like if it's just an orange peel type texture, you mm-hmm. can find a sponge, like your scrubbing sponge or something like that.
Yeah,
like you wash your joint compound on it and tap it in, just kind of tap it in. Anyway, it takes a little bit of, work, but it's finesse and it turns out really nice usually if you just take your time.
Okay, so if I'm understanding this right, let's say you have a hole in the drywall the size of a deck of cards.
Okay.
What you do is you cut a strip that is maybe the same top to bottom width as the deck of cards, but you make it twice as long.
Exactly.
And then you stick it in through the hole, kind of holding it on one side. And how do you get it so it doesn't fall through? Do you screw a piece of drywall to the front center part of it, or?
Yeah, well, you put a drywall screw in the middle of the piece that you're sliding through the hole. Oh,
just a drywall screw, so you have something to hold on to.
And then once you have it in position, you put a drywall screw on either side.
On the left and right of where that deck of cards is. Now you have a backing there. And now you cut a piece of drywall the perfect size, of a deck of cards, put it in there, and then screw it and then mud it.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
There you go.
I've done the same trick with a paint stick. Yeah, a paint stick.
Yeah.
Okay. I like the drywall better though. It's a much better backing because with the paint stick, it's always kind of like a little mobile.
And the paint sticks are thin and it's usually
cheap, it's a little flimsy and it's better than nothing, but it's not that's a pro tip right there. I like that one. Okay, well,
you got a lot of holes over there, Steve. What's going on?
I've been doing drywall wrong for 41 years apparently. do you have any other little tricks like that?
Oh, I'm sure I do.
Yeah.
I'm kind of putting you on the spot here.
Yeah.
All right. Well, if you think of them as we go, let me know.
Okay.
Let's see. What else we got? Solar panels. Is it true that solar panels are required on all new construction in California? Is that
pretty correct? Much so, yes.
Pretty much so. Okay.
Yeah. Now, there are exceptions. They're kind of hard to come by. And they have to be approved. For instance, if you live in an area where there's lots of trees and you're not getting any solar access, then they can't really make you put solar in because it wouldn't work.
It would be stupid.
Well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So
like I live in the forest.
There's exceptions like that, but generally, they're trying to push it right now so much. So when the big mandate, which I think is in 2030 or something, comes in and that's when they want everybody off on solar, which I don't know if everybody's on solar, can the grid handle that?
TBD.
Yeah, exactly.
Huh. So, and what's the cost on that,
Steve?
What's that?
I'm sorry, what's that?
Oh, I was just asking what the cost, typically, like, the added cost to do solar on the ADUs.
Well, you can get solar done for free if you want.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, there's companies
out
there.
So Daniel could get solar for free on his ADU.
Exactly.
How do you do that?
A lot of solar companies offer it. What they'll do is they'll take your credit back, and then you pay, $25 a month or something like that, just one flat fee, but they get the rights to your overage that you're putting back into the grid. So they're, oh, wow. They have a few different plans like
so that. So you're kind of like a little miniature power plant for them.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, interesting.
So, and you know, there's, and if you want to, you know, do more of it, you know, DIY yourself, it's, you can buy used panels. Some people, you know, they think that the panels are going to be, you know, shot after 2 years. And so they buy new ones. And used ones can last 30, 40 years. So.
Oh, wow.
Really?
And you're paying, if you buy them, there's a place in Arizona you can buy them for like $15 a piece for a, you know, a 3x4 panel.
You're,
yeah. Wow. That's the bottom end, you know?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, okay.
But you, it's affordable. It's affordable.
It is definitely you can make affordable.
Well, it sounds free, but.
If it's free, it's me.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if you do it yourself, or you know, you pay to have it done, which you know, it can be pretty cheap because there's a lot of companies out there and they're competitive nowadays. Yeah. So they're doing it very reasonably. And you know, if you just do it on your own, then you get the money back. You know, and like here we have Edison, and they will, I think it's twice a year they give you a check. This is what we, you know, used, and this is what you used, and thank you, and here's your check.
Interesting. Uh-huh. Okay. Uh-huh. Yeah. I like the idea of a $25 electric bill. That sounds
pretty
cool.
I have a friend that did that, and he got him on the line here. He'd talk forever about it. He loves it.
That might be an interesting interview.
Yeah.
Did he put it in himself, or did he have a company do it?
No, that's just all he had a company do it, and I think he pays $25. It was a couple of years ago, and pays $25 a month, and they come in, they put the new panel in, the inverter and everything. And you know, he's a little older than me, so he's, you know, he's a retired roofer actually.
Okay. But, that's why I like
anyway,
it
so he pays like $25 a month, and after I think 30 years, he owns it.
Huh.
Oh.
But yeah, I don't think he's planning to be here for much.
Yeah. We'll see how that works out.
Yeah. He can watch it from above.
Yeah.
But yeah, he was, you know, he had his two sons were, you know, heavy into games, you know, online and, you know, TV and stuff. So his electric bill was pretty large. And so dropping it down to $25 a month was a godsend to him.
Yeah, that's why you won't shut up about it.
Exactly.
Okay, what about fire sprinklers? Are those required in Santa Barbara?
Not necessarily. It depends on the area. If you're in a high fire area, yes, they are required. So, for instance, down in Ventura, in your area, Steve, if you're up in the hills, they are requiring it.
Yeah, they already burned down once just a couple years ago.
Yeah.
That's here in Santa Barbara, where you are, Daniel, you don't need to have them. You're not in high fire. Although the Riviera has burned a few times.
No, it has. Well, I got like a 20 something foot, you know, wall to help protect me a little bit.
It's like, I know the wall.
My wall is like a story, so.
It is.
Well, they won't protect you from a wildland fire, but if someone starts a kitchen fire, you won't lose the place. Okay, what zoning requirements are there? R1, R2, does
a lot have to be a certain requirements? There's no, I mean, you can be R1, R2, R3, whatever. There are some issues where people want to put them in a industrial zone or commercial zone. And that's kind of a sticky thing that, you know, whoever municipality has control over it, they have to make that decision. They're allowing it pretty much, it's from what I've heard, in ag areas. You know, if you have like zoned agriculture, you know, you might have a ranch house and you can do an ADU as well.
Okay.
So, those are kind of just, depending on where you live and stuff, but,
Okay. Let's see. I wrote down, local planning and development permits. What can you tell us about,
permits.
Dealing with the government and the inspectors is this something they come out, you know, once in the beginning and once at the end, or is this like every week?
No, they'll come out more than that. They want to see, although since they're not getting paid much, the state mandated it's $457 to get your permit for an ADU in California compared to thousands.
Yeah.
A roofing permit is like more than double that.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Just a re-roof.
Yeah. That's what I did. It was like $900.
Yeah.
You got to get a permit to re-roof your house.
Oh, you have to get a permit to put a new water heater in, supposedly.
Yeah. Yes, you do. Yep. Okay. You do. Yep.
And just made some guy under the table.
I know.
Okay.
No comment. But yeah, so the permitting is pretty cheap. And so that kind of lends itself to where the inspectors don't want to spend a lot of time coming out to inspect your ADU. They'll come out and they'll do, you know, a rough inspection for rough electrical and plumbing, probably all at the same time. And other than that, I mean, they're not going to really be sticklers on it. So as long as it's built according to the plans, you're going to be in good shape. Okay.
Oh, that's good news.
I forgot. I probably should have led with this sooner. So, for example, for Daniel's ADU, $1,250 square feet, two story. What's the time frame on that from start to finish after jumping through all the permit hoops and
construction? Once construction starts, depending on who he has as his subcontractors and things, it could be done in 30 to 60 days, no problem.
Oh, wow.
Wow. I didn't know.
I mean, it's not that big, and it's a square box, what I'm drawing up.
Yeah.
So it's not too complicated.
Huh.
I just want my balcony.
It has a 24-foot balcony across the front.
Yep, that's it.
Interesting.
We're good.
Yeah. I saw some of the preliminary drawings. It looks really cool.
Well, one quick note is I actually had asked you, I'm like, hey, Steve, well, because I wanted a kind of a railing thing on the top, kind of a sun deck, you know, slash garden or something, you know.
Yeah.
But he was saying, Steve was actually saying how a flat roof really isn't all that great. And so that was something that I actually learned from him. And Eddie, he made a lot of sense because he said that, I believe you said that you would, I don't know if you said you would put one in yourself or your place or somebody else's. In
my house.
Yeah, they tend to sag a bit over time.
Oh, yeah, yeah. My house was built with a flat roof in 1958. And you can ask my wife and kids how many times I was on the roof putting plastic up during rainstorms because the darn thing would leak if you'd fix it one spot and then another spot would start leaking. So that's why I don't have a flat roof anymore.
So you recommend pitched roofs, not
Definitely. You know, it just saves you grief down the road. You know, a lot of people will do them, and even though you can put on a flat roof, you can put, you know, slight pitches so it drains, but over time, you know, because most of them are done with asphalt, and the asphalt will start sagging, the asphalt sheeting will start sagging in between the ceiling joists or the roof rafters or whatever you use. And then it just makes puddles. And once it starts puddling, it wears out quicker. So your 30-year roof is now a 5-year roof.
Now, what about one-story versus two-story? Do you ever see things like maybe build a one-story ADU with the anticipation of going two-story, or just do two-story right from the get-go and don't even?
You're better off to do it from the beginning, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, it's just that, a remodel addition to an ADU would be, I think, not cost effective.
It's just a nightmare. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Because you're tearing apart things to rebuild on top of it. And plus you know, if you're planning on doing that, you would want it all engineered for a second story to begin with.
Yeah.
So you might as well just put the second story on.
Put it on from the get go. Don't start don't try to compartmentize this and just build the four units, the fourplex, if that's what you're going to do.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. Okay. 2x4 versus 2x6 exterior wall. Daniel's going with the 2x6, more sturdy. Eats up a little bit of that floor space, right? Because the 1250 is counting from the exterior wall, correct?
Correct. Yeah, it does eat up a little bit of floor space. It's okay. I mean, I don't necessarily say it's much better, you know, you're going to get the same structural strength from a 2x4 wall just by the structural engineering that goes on. It'll be a little more rigorous in a 2x4 than a 2x6. But all in all, it's, you know, it's just a matter of preference. You know, if you like the thick feeling of 2x6 walls, then you get better, you know, window, you know, coverage. It looks a little nicer.
Yeah. So better insulation.
Better. Well, yeah, you're going to have, I mean, we live in Southern California. It's not like we don't need R30. Yeah, good point. You just open the
windows and you're fine. It's not Idaho, Steve. Yeah,
it's aesthetics. It's aesthetics here.
Yeah, it's aesthetics here.
Up in Wyoming, it would be a different story. Okay.
Yeah.
What, let's see, what else do we got, Dan? Ceiling heights, maybe like as far as, I'm sure there's regulations, you can't build a four-story place in the back of there, right? So there's got to be a height.
Well, there are height requirements, which the, each municipality has their own requirements. Santa Barbara's 30 feet, so you can definitely have, you know, high ceilings to get up to that 30-foot height. So, yeah, and like what Daniel is doing, I kind of drawn things out to where it's going to have both in the downstairs and the upstairs high ceilings. I was thinking in some parts of the upstairs, we can have what we call box beams, which aren't really structural, but they look like they are.
Okay. Yep.
So, you know, you can just add some nice aesthetic things that don't cost you too much.
What's a box beam? Is it 2 2x10s with a 2x4 or something? Or
generally, you can do it with 1x. You can put like a 2x4.
Oh, because you paint it and then you never. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Huh. Interesting.
So yeah, there's, you know, little tricks like that that you can do.
Okay.
Yeah, as long as I get my knitting room, I'm good.
Yeah, this is a porcelain pony craft room. Care Bear craft room. Yes.
There you go.
My little pony. Yeah. So okay. So for his downstairs. Is there some things that maybe go easier in the permitting process? For example, if you have a hobby room or a craft room, and after everything's done, it's like, you know what, this would be better as a garage or vice versa, or are there little tricks like
or
that?
Or an Airbnb?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's definitely little tricks to that. For instance, I've got Daniel's designed as a one-car garage.
Okay.
But it also has a rather large storage area and then internal stairs going up to the second story, which also has a lot of room in it. So in a sense, it's just a garage with storage and a one bedroom unit on top. Now, if you made changes down the road, I don't care.
Yeah, okay.
That bathroom.
I'm not
going to
tell anybody. You know,
it's really a pain in the ass when you get out of your car if you don't have a urinal right in front of you, right?
You know, that's it.
With a sink and hell, let's put a shower in there. I don't want to have to walk upstairs for that.
Yeah, I got a small bladder.
Yeah.
Years ago, I built a place here in Santa Barbara. It was a three-car garage with a studio apartment above because that's all the city would allow at that time. And the owner, elderly, and he puttered around and, you know, was keeping one of the garages just to do his hobbies in and stuff like that. And he didn't always want to go, if he had to use the restroom, to go upstairs. Well, the city wouldn't let us put a bathroom downstairs. So we plumbed it. So if you ever wanted to go to the city and get permission, or bootleg it in, which I have no idea if he did or not, the plumbing was there.
It was accessible.
Yeah.
It was accessible.
I'll be curious if you could tell me whether I put a toilet down here or not. With regard to plumbing, I was in Nicaragua, I was watching them build some houses. I was there with Daniel a couple months ago, and they were building some little studios. And one thing the guy said that I hadn't thought of was he said you run the... make the toilet the last thing in the line of plumbing as possible. So when you put in the plumbing for the bathroom, have the shower run through that as well. Is that something that
Traps, yeah, depending or? On the setup, you're allowed to have certain, you know, a certain amount of fixtures per drain line.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So it just kind of depends. But having the toilet at the end, I can kind of see that in some respects. But as long as, you know, I recommend if you can, most of the time, you know, make sure you've got a clean out near your toilet.
Yeah. Okay.
That's where sometimes plugs happen.
AKA that's a concentration of incidents right there.
Yeah. Yes.
So clean outs are important, Steve.
They're very important.
I really like this idea of rentals and then kind of, you know, having a house and then having an ADU in the back. I've been a landlord for a while, and I think especially in the current economic environment with inflation, rents are only going to go higher. You know, that's one real easy way to fight inflation is to be a landlord.
It really is, you know, and in a lot of cases, it's a really smart way to go. Yeah. And you can design it to where, you know, the ADU is a separated kind of unit with proper landscaping and stuff. It can be very private and not part of your normal, you know, your regular house. So it's a good thing. I think the state was wise in doing this. It'll help overcrowding of land and using up land that should be left alone.
Oh, one thing we didn't go over was parking.
Oh yeah, that's right.
No extra parking requirements.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
Huh. Okay.
Yeah, because that was one of the issues that the cities were squawking about and trying to fight the ADU.
Oh, so that's kind of omitted at this point?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, they can't realize that.
They can't add any more parking requirements. Well, and in Santa Barbara, you know, since now you can convert a garage, they don't even have, you don't have to have covered parking anymore, even if you're building a new house.
Oh, wow. So,
yeah, it's kind of strange.
Okay. Yeah.
It is. Yeah. I mean, when I redid put my second story on, they came and looked at my garage, and I had my washer and dryer in the garage. And you go, oh, well, you have to get a special variance because you have your washer and dryer, and you can't fit two cars in. Well, sure, I can. Rolls Royces, but
you know. Yeah, little Mini Coopers.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of ridiculous. Even the lady in the city thought it was ridiculous that they were making me do that. Wow. But they did.
All right, on. Cool. Well, this has been fun. Do you have any other questions, Daniel?
So just kind of like Steve, just so we like an overview, just so people can get a kind of a sense, you know, start to completion. I know we're in California, obviously it's a lot more expensive here, coastal areas, New York, maybe, you know, but, as far as prices, but, you know, generally speaking, you know, $100 a square foot, you know, we're going, you know, mid to high end, maybe like, you know, a $100 to $150, would you say?
I would say that's an easy doable thing. Mm-hmm. And if you're really diligent about, you know, conserving money and funds and, you know, buying things that, you know, like through Habitat for Humanity restores and things like that, God, you can pick up doors for, you know, pennies on the dollar and stuff. So you can save money that way. So you could get it down to, you know, $75-$80 a square foot.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. When Steve told me the price for, you know, like a, you know, mid range to, you know, mid high, maybe even, you know, was under $200K, you know, is that right, Steve? Which was like not even a blink of my eye, where as opposed to getting a contractor, getting everything, you know, getting, you know, full company coming in, probably double, would you say? You know, so, you know, 400, you know, upwards of 400, if not more. So you could do it if you're willing to kind of be diligent and put the work in, put some work in yourself, because obviously that's what it takes, a little bit of sweat equity in there. You can get it, you know, from say a really nice place for 200 or a little or less, you know, depending on how much, how much work you want to put into it. So I personally was like, and I was really hesitant. I'm like, oh, well, I'll be doing this in 5 years, you know? Yeah. And then I ran into Steve and I go, like, oh, let's do that yesterday.
Yeah. Like, man, I'm really glad my car had trouble now.
Yeah. Thank God for that oil leak.
Yeah. Literally saved me $300,000.
Yeah. Yeah, Bert's a good guy. One other thing that I suggest, and you know, a lot of general contractors are going to be mad for me saying this, but act as your own. If you have the time to oversee some stuff, act as your own general contractor. You can utilize a person like me as, you know, as somebody to come out and check progress. You know, it's just a project consultant or something. You know, because if you have a general on it, he's tacking on a lot of money most of the time. And, you know, it really doesn't pay to have a general unless you, you know, just want to be totally hands off. Then I kind of suggest it. But people like you are
not easy to find, Steve. I have to admit, you're not really? Like, yeah.
Yeah. Apparently you gotta go hit your car with a hammer first. And then, that's how we find it. Hang on. Let me slash a couple of my tires. Then Steve will show up.
Well, being your own general, I mean, it's pretty simple. You know, you ask around, okay, who's a good concrete guy? You know, and this guy and this guy, or, you know, who's a good framer? There's a lot of people out there that have the attitude that I do. You know, it's you don't need to make a killing on every job. You know?
Yeah. So, and we're doing this as an owner when we submit this to the to the city, to the planning and zoning is owner builder.
So I'll be your agent so I can submit these things for you. So, you know, and, you know, I don't charge a whole lot, so it is cost effective to use me or to use. There's other people that do what I do as well.
Yeah.
What is your price? Do you go by square foot or what?
Generally go by an hourly rate, and it kind of depends on the project, but generally it's under $50 an hour. So.
Well, that sounds like it's worth its weight in gold.
I will be
calling you, Steve, when I'm in Daniel's position.
Yeah, you pretty much got another customer. So
yeah,
he's been talking about this for a little bit of time.
So, yeah, I even have it as like one of my 2021 goals on my mirror. So this is kind of working in just right.
He's okay, probably going to be bugging me like, "Hey, are you almost done yet with this?"
Right on. Okay, so if a listener wants to get a hold of you, Steve Tepper Construction, they can email you at TEPBEAR@gmail.com or call you at 805-448-2526.
That's it.
Right on. Cool. Yeah, good deal. Well, thank you very much for coming on, Steve. This was this was fun.
Yeah, it was. It was really fun.
We got to have Steve on. Yeah, we got to have him on like in the middle of construction.
Yes. We'll have you back on as we're making progress.
We can hear Daniel's complaints and
yes,
he wants any change orders.
Yeah, no.
I'll act as his angry wife that is just screaming on the other side of the room. It'll make you feel right at home.
Boy, it was a funny experience. I hope I never have that one again.
Hey, as of now, I'm single, so we're good.
Good deal. Okay, well, thank you, Steve.
Thank you, guys.
Awesome, Steve. Great time.
And thank you. Thank you for listening. Thank you for telling a friend. And thank you for tuning in. Here is your weekly motivational speech.
For now, what you want to focus on is you're hopelessly average. Amazing. And now it's about recognizing that the average human being is designed to learn and grow and to get better. And so now it's a question of how do we put enough time and energy into something to actually get better at that thing? And that really is the key that we want to focus on.
I think when you feel stuck or dissatisfied in your life, it's a signal. And it's not a signal that your life is broken. It's a signal that one of your most basic needs are not being met. Your need for exploration. Everything about your life, about your body, grows. Your cells regenerate, your hair, your nails, everything grows for your entire life. And your soul needs exploration and growth. And the only way you'll get it is by forcing yourself to be uncomfortable.
What's the most important key to success? I think it's hunger. It's not getting satisfied. A hunger that doesn't go away. A hunger to learn, a hunger to grow, a hunger to serve, a hunger to give, a hunger to create breakthroughs. Most people are hungry until they make a certain amount of money and then they get comfortable. And there's nothing wrong with that, but it's not about the money. It's not about the business. It's about your growth. Because every one of us either grows or dies. People ask me all the time, what does it take to be happy? I say one word, progress. Progress equals happiness, because achieving a goal feels good for how long? A week, a month, 3 months? And then there needs to be something else. And the reason for something else is because you gotta grow.
The only thing that I think people should fear is standing still. So I've often said that running 1,000 miles an hour in the wrong direction is better than standing still.
Stop waiting for something to move you and move yourself. Every day, move yourself. In the morning, move yourself. In the afternoon, move yourself. At night, move yourself. Be very intentional and very deliberate about moving yourself.